don't you, rather than knowing about it ahead of time? So I don't know if that was the wisdom or that's how it was planned, but it worked out great. The children may be released at this time. Not all at once, just be careful, don't run over anybody. But the kids can go to Bible hour now. We're going to be in Daniel 3 in just a minute. It's going to be our first passage tonight. I grew up in the South. And in the South, manners, especially verbal manners, are pushed. To say please and thank you. I was raised saying yes sir and no sir and yes ma'am and no ma'am. Matter of fact, if we didn't say it, somebody would stop us and say, excuse me? And then we had to say it in order to go on to do the next thing. At some point, we raised our boys the same way. We moved to Wyoming and a teacher called me from school and said, it sounds very smart alecky when your kids say yes ma'am and no ma'am. I'm like, well, it's not. That's how they've been raised, and so they mean that. They're told to do that. Now, if they're rolling their eyes when they say it, call me then. I want to know about that, because eye rolling is not okay. Did you, all you teenagers, get that? Eye rolling is not okay? It's a work of the devil. I'm here to tell you. But sincerely, being polite and honest and open and being friendly and warm, all those things were very welcomed. I didn't learn till we got married about something called a thank you note. Any of y'all know what a thank you note is? I had never, as a teenage boy, I had never written a thank you note to anybody. We weren't made to do that. And then we got married, and there were all these lovely gifts people gave us. And Latina one night said, Joe, there's a table full of these gifts, and I need you to go through, and I need you to tell me the name on the gift and what the gift is. And I was like, why? Why do we need to write that down? Just take a picture of it and, you know, there it is. A table full of gifts. That was nice, right? She said, no, no, we have to write thank you notes. What? I told them, thank you. I appreciated them for the gift. She was like, no, this is important. We have to do this. And so we wrote thank you notes. I didn't. I didn't write any thank you notes. I said, we, honey, because we're one. That's what they said at the wedding. She wrote all the thank you notes. It took a long time to get all those done. And, you know, we were newlyweds. I'm like, give me a break. We got other things to do. But anyway, thank you notes are something we appreciate. And now when somebody sends me a thank you note, I do appreciate that. It means something to me. I'm thankful that you noticed something and that you told me thank you. I appreciate it. Have you ever thought about sending a thank you note to somebody in advance of them doing something for you? Now, the closest I can get to that is I knew a guy in Wyoming. I met him through the campus ministry. He was not the age of all the students in the campus ministry. He was an older guy. But he wandered onto the campus one day, and he came to the Christian Student Center, and he walked in, and he was from Iraq. He was a real friendly guy. His name was Mahmoud. And Mahmoud came in, and he was probably about 45 years old. But he wanted to talk to me about the Bible and about God, and he had a faith of some sort. And he had questions, and we would talk. Mahmoud had a little trick he would do. It was really interesting. He would say, God loves you. Thank you for being kind. And then he would ask you to do something for him. He was really good at it. He was talented. He would do that. We would see him, and then it would be a few weeks, and then we wouldn't see him, and then he'd come back again. We'd see him again for a week or two, and then we wouldn't see him again. I went to speak at a retreat in Colorado, several hours from where we were in Wyoming. And while I was there, the people at the church said, hey, we know a mutual friend. I said, who? They said, Mahmoud. And I said, Mahmoud has made it down here? They said, yeah, he comes through every few weeks. I said, God loves you. Thank you for being kind. They said, that's it. That's him. It was great. His thank you meant, I'm about to ask something of you. I want you to think about how do we thank God and when do we thank God? Usually we thank God for something that we see him doing today, or something he's already done for us. And we stop and we say, God, thank you for that thing I asked you for, and then you gave me. But there's a sense in which we as God's people need to be thanking God all the time for things that he hasn't yet done. Things we haven't yet witnessed him do, or say, or be in our lives. So let's think about that a little bit. Let's read a couple of passages. Let's look at Daniel chapter 3. You know the story. There's these three guys that are oddly named, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And the king comes and says, hey, you have to honor me. Actually, one of his people had made a trick, and they're pulling this trick to try to single out Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And so the plan is that you have to hold in high honor King Nebuchadnezzar. And when they hear the sound of these instruments playing, you have to bow before this great, powerful statue of the king, and you have to worship the image of gold. And they were told this. This was communicated to the whole land. All the people had to do this. Because this man, this trickster, knew that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego didn't honor the king as God, that they honored God as God. And he knew about their behavior, their pattern, their worship, their praying that they did on a daily basis. And so he knew he could put them in an odd spot. And so he does that. And when the music plays, they do not bow. Verse 13, let's pick up, of Daniel 3. Furious with rage, Nebuchadnezzar summoned Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So these men were brought before the king. And Nebuchadnezzar said to them, is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods or worship the image of gold I have set up? Now when you hear the sound of the horn, the flute, the zither, the lyre, the harps, the pipes, and all kinds of music, if you are ready to fall down and worship the image I made, very good. But if you do not worship it, you will be thrown immediately into a blazing furnace. Then what God will be able to rescue you from my hand? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you in this matter. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God we serve is able to save us from it, and he will rescue us from your hand, O king. Look at the next few words here. But even if he does not, we want you to know, O king, that we will not serve your gods or worship the image of gold you've set up. The God that we serve is able to deliver. Do you believe tonight that the God that we serve is able to deliver? I'm here to tell you, we as God's people have to believe that. Now what that doesn't mean is that we know what he will do. And I'm here to tell you, I do not know what God is going to do. I don't. I do know what he's promised, and I know that we can hold that safe, that that's right, that that's true, that he's going to do that. But I want you to know that God does not speak to me daily and tell me, hey, don't worry, in this particular matter you've prayed about, Joe, this is what I'm going to do. He doesn't tell me that. He doesn't tell you, does he? I don't hear that. Yet I know that whatever he's going to do is right. And it's the way that he means for things to work out. Even when, after he works it out, I don't understand it. Can I tell you, in my life, I have looked back and can amen that country song that says, thank God for unanswered prayers. You know what I'm talking about? Really, what he means is, thank God for the prayers he answered that didn't go the way that I wanted. Because now, looking back, I can see that would have been terrible. That wasn't the right answer. There's others that I prayed and asked for things, and I didn't get what I asked for. And I don't understand it. I still don't. Yet, it doesn't mean that he's not God. You see? And that's a hard thing sometimes for us to understand. Is that our God is mighty and able, and he can do incredible things. God can fix everything. But just because he doesn't work it out the way I've planned doesn't mean that it didn't work out. It also means that he didn't answer the prayer. He did answer the prayer. He just didn't give me the answer that I wanted. Can I tell you, there are some other times that I'm still waiting for that to play out the way it's going to play out. And I've seen him do that too. His timetable is real different than mine. And God shows us that in his word. I'm thankful that we have some examples of people like this who say, God, we know you're able to do it, and even if it doesn't work out that way, we're still going to trust you. Sometimes when I read scripture, I get the idea that these people knew everything before it happened. It's easy to think that. It's easy to read their story and think, well, the reason they're so confident is because they knew the end of the story. No, they didn't. They were living in it. Just like we are living in it. And what we honor and admire about these people often, the reason we hold them up as examples of faith, is because they were confident in God's answer, even though they didn't know what it would be yet. That requires faith. And it's not easy. It's not easy to thank God in advance when we don't know what's going to happen. And yet I believe that that's what God is calling on us as His people to do in the world that we live in today. Next passage is over in John, chapter 20. Turn over there. I feel more like this guy sometimes, starting in verse 24 of John 20. Now Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." We saw him. That was incredible to him because the Lord had died. He saw that. But he said, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe it." Do we have some of those people here tonight? Do you kind of feel like that sometimes? Now, if you really do feel that way, you should go a little further east because that is the show me state, right across the state line there, right? That's Missouri. It's the show me state. And sometimes we're the show me people. I want to see it. If you'll show it to me, if you'll do what I want, then I'll believe. There's people that have actually come and sat with me and studied God's word and then said, you know what, I have this thing I'm asking God to do, and if He'll do that, then I'll obey. Well, it doesn't work like that. It doesn't work that way. You have to believe. You have to believe first. Really? I have to believe first? Are you sure that's right? Well, let's see what Jesus does with Thomas. A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them, and he said, "Peace be with you." That must have been shocking. That must have been shocking, just Jesus showing up through a locked door. Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here, see my hands. And reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." That must have been an incredible moment. I would have loved to have been able to be there. And even if I hadn't asked, like Thomas did, to do that, I would think if I was there and I saw Thomas do that and get to touch Jesus' hands and get to put his hand in his side, I would have said, "Well, could I do it too? Wouldn't you?" You would have wanted to confirm it for sure, just to know for a fact, so that you could tell other people, "Hey, I did it. I felt the hole in his hand. I know that it was so. I was there. I saw it firsthand. I touched him. He was real. He wasn't a ghost." Because that's what they thought at first when they saw him. Jesus says to him, "Stop doubting and believe." This man from this point forward has the name what? What do we call him? Doubting Thomas, don't we? I want to sort of poke at him and say, "Why did you doubt?" But I've doubted too. Haven't you? Haven't you wondered? Have you ever in your own life sort of put God to the test? "God, I believe in you, but I'll really believe in you more if you'll do this thing that I need done. If I get the job that I've been looking for, then I'll really believe. If you'll make my family whole again, then I'll really believe. If you'll take care of this person that I love who's sick, then I'll really believe." I think we make those bargains. I think we do. It's tempting to do it. Thomas at this says what? "My Lord and my God." He gets it. Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." You know, Jesus was talking about some people that were alive then who believed in him, although they didn't get to see him. Not everybody saw him after his resurrection. But I think he's also talking about, us. Don't you? I think he's talking about us. Blessed are those people who don't get to see me in person and yet still believe in me. That's us. I think we're blessed for believing, although we don't see it. And that's what our faith is, isn't it? Our faith is having hope and confidence in something we don't see right now, that hasn't yet happened. That is the essence of what it means to have faith. And that's the essence of what God's calling on us as His people to believe in. To believe in Him. To believe what He's done. To believe the plan of redemption He's laid out. To believe that being obedient to Him is going to produce in us something eternal and everlasting. That's an awesome thing. And yes, He's calling us to believe it without direct evidence. There's a lot of things you can see today and you can hold. I think the teachings of Scripture are powerful. They're awesome. There's a lot of archaeological evidence out there that we can have faith in. There's extra-biblical writers, people that aren't Bible writers, that were historians that wrote about Christ. There's every reason we have to believe. But can I tell you, ultimately, to believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ, you have to have faith. I don't have a YouTube video for that. It's just not there. You have to have faith. To believe that, you know, taking this remembrance that we do on the first day of the week, that is, in essence, we are remembering the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. That takes a leap of faith, doesn't it? Sure. God says believing is an important part of what we bring to the table. We have to believe. And we can't remove that from this picture. It's easy sometimes for us to say, how can anybody not believe it? They just don't. We live in a world of people that don't believe things if they don't see it. And if you can't show it to them, they won't believe it. And we sort of live in the same world, don't we? How many of y'all make agreements on important contracts with a handshake? Anybody here bought a car on a handshake? Any of you have bought your house on a handshake? Just tell me. I'd be interested to talk to you later. Because I'll tell you, I think that's crazy. Right? Because we're people that like to see things. I want to see it in writing. I want to read every part of it. Matter of fact, if it's too complicated for me to read, I will pay a guy who will read it for me and tell me that it's okay for me to sign that. And so, you know, that's the world we live in today. We want to see it. We have right in our pockets, most of us, or in a purse, you've got one of these. If something happens, if tomorrow you go out and somebody has hit your car in the parking lot, you know the first thing you'll do? Take a picture of it. And you'll send it to somebody to make that right, won't you? That's what we do. We want evidence for everything. And yet here God is, the God, the Almighty God of the universe, that could provide us anything He wanted, and what He gives us is a chance to believe in something. Think about that for a minute. He could overwhelm us with evidence. He could give us proof for everything, couldn't He? But that's not what He does. He calls on us to believe in something that we haven't yet seen happen. Our faith is based on something that we haven't yet seen happen. That's important. We don't need to miss that. We need to get that idea through our heads. And sometimes it's challenging. Hebrews chapter 11. Go over there. Great passage. Verse 6. "And without faith it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to Him must believe that He exists and that He rewards those who earnestly seek Him." We have to start by believing that God exists. That's important. I want to tell you, more than any other unifying fact, there's a whole bunch of people in the world today that believe that God exists. If you corner them, they will tell you that. They will not say, "Well, I believe that Scripture is true." They might not say, "I believe in all the different stories in the Bible," but they will often say, "I believe that there is a God." Their faith just hasn't gone beyond that. And let me tell you something. It's possible for our faith to stop right there, to say, there is a God. Is that a saving faith? Because it goes on. It doesn't just say, I mean, that's not the end of the verse. And without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to Him must believe He exists, period. No, that's not what it says. And that He rewards those who do what? Who earnestly seek Him. Can I tell you, our job as Christian people is to earnestly seek after God. I think it's one of the failed things that we don't do very often as Christians. We come in and we seek God and we find the church. And then sometimes we're satisfied with that. That's enough. Can I tell you something? The church is awesome. It is the bride of Christ. It is what we are placed in when we are baptized into His body. This is His body, the church. But the thing that we should spend our life seeking after is God. That's what He's calling us to do. We begin with our faith that He exists. And then we seek Him with the rest of our existence. I am still every day having to wake up and say, God, I'm looking for You. I want to do what You want me to do. I want to follow You the way that You've called me to follow You. I find myself imperfect in that. How about you? I guess if I woke up one morning and I thought, I have done it all perfectly, I would just ask for Him to kill me that day so that I could be done. But I haven't gotten there yet. I feel like I'm always reaching for that. He's calling me to be better. He's calling me to be more of what He's asked for me to be. He's calling me to let go of this world and to be called toward Him. He's asking, Joe, if you'll seek after Me, I will continually reward you. How? All right, I don't think that means monetarily. All right, so I'm not a great TV preacher, okay? Although I may be on YouTube later, I'm not a great TV preacher. That's not what I'm doing. And I'm not saying, hey, if you'll just make your commitment, He will bless you and you'll go home, there'll be cars in the driveway and you'll get a new house, and I'm not teaching you that. I'm telling you that the rewards that God gives us mean more to us as we get closer to Him, because they're spiritual in nature. I believe that. And I believe we are rewarded as we grow closer to Him, which means letting go of this world. I think by the time the apostles get close to the end of their lives, and Scripture demonstrates this, that they are people that the world doesn't even understand. It was tough. The prophets, by the time they get to the point of their death, they are so much closer to God and so far away from the world doesn't even get them. Doesn't understand how they think. Look down here in verse 13 of Hebrews 11. All these people were still living by faith when they died. They did not receive the things promised. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance. And they admitted that they were aliens and strangers on the earth. Isn't that awesome? Aren't we as God's people? Shouldn't we be those kind of people? Although we don't get to see all the blessings, although we don't get to see the realization of all the things God can do, we believe in it so much that it propels us forward, that it moves us forward. And we do things here, spiritual things, we act in such a way in our lives that we demonstrate that we believe the promises of God are true, even if our life is hard. I don't think that as Christians, we just get an easier life. Do you? I don't think that's the promise. I don't think that's the promise of the reward of God. I do not believe that if we are able to put a group together, which some of you today filled out on your card, you want to go to the plant, awesome. If you haven't yet filled out your card, catch me in the back, we'll talk. But the fact is that I don't believe that that's going to be easy. I don't think staying here is going to be easy. I don't think living our lives as God has asked us to live them is easy. It's not easy. But anything worth doing is worth doing right, isn't it? And He calls us to something better and higher. And it's a spiritual growth. It's a spiritual movement forward. It's spiritual reward that He promises us. That's different than physical. And I don't think that's what God's trying to call us to. He's calling us to something different. Read a few more verses here before we move on. Verse 14. People who say such things show that they are looking for a country of their own. If they had been thinking of the country they had left, they would have had the opportunity to return. Instead, they were longing for a better country, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for He has prepared a city for them. I want to try to be the kind of follower of His that God says, I'm not ashamed to be called the God that Joe Brumfield serves. I try to do that. I want to do that. I want him to be able to say, I'm proud. Not because I'm perfect. I make mistakes all the time. I do things I'm not supposed to. There's improvement that's needed in me on a daily basis. But the fact is that I believe we need to focus on what he's calling us to and let go of all this stuff in the world that we live in. It's so easy to get caught up in it. It's so hard to let go of it. We need to make some moves and do some things that God will have to help us in, or we won't be able to accomplish them. I think one of those is the church plant. Some of you right now are thinking, we're going to miss our friends. Yes, you will. You won't see them as often. You can still get together with them. I pray that you do. Some of you that have never done it are going to have a Bible study in your home. I'm going to ask you to do that. If you're going to go with the plant, one of the things we need to do is we need to have home Bible studies. Those are helpful. You can invite a friend or a neighbor to a home Bible study that might be a little more intimidated to walk in here the first time, but they'd come in your home because they like you, they know you, they work with you, they trust you. Bring them in your home. Let them know that you love the Lord. Tell them about your faith. Share that with them. I'm telling you, more people than you would believe are out there longing for something that is bigger and better than this world has to offer. They've been beat up. They've been whipped. They've gotten sick. They've lost people. They've been through the same things we've been through, but there's a difference. We realize that the God that we serve is able. He is able to deliver us, even if the way He delivers us is not what I initially asked Him for. It's much like children. How many times have your kids asked you for something? They were just sure, if you would give me this thing, that would be it. I would never ask you for anything again. Come on, you remember doing that when you were a kid, don't you? And your kids have done that to you too. And you know the whole time, that is not going to satisfy them. And so at some point you realize that that's just not going to work out. And you have to break the bad news to them. I'm not doing that. We're not doing that. We're going to do something better. Oh, they're like, better? And you're like, we're putting that money in a trust fund for your college. No. I want a pony. Do you not get this? A pony, a trust fund. That does not sound equally fun to me. But then when they're older, right, and they go off to college and there's some money socked away for them, they appreciate that pretty good. So we realize things that they don't know yet. Do you think God is maybe a little bit ahead of us? Do you think God is maybe a little bit larger than we are? Do you think God maybe understands a little bit more than us? Even more than we may be ahead of our children. God is far superior to us. God knows things we don't know and understand. And you know what? Because He's God and He's sovereign, He doesn't have to tell me that either. He just tells me one thing. Joe, you trust me. You let other people see you trusting me. That's an important part of our faith, isn't it? Last passage I want you to turn to is back over here in Matthew chapter 8. Matthew chapter 8. It's an example of enormous faith, and it's not the prophets, and it's not the apostles. Matter of fact, I don't really even know what to call him. I'll just call him the centurion, because that's what Scripture calls him. Verse 5, beginning of Matthew 8. When Jesus had entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him, asking for help. Lord, he said, my servant lies at home paralyzed and in terrible suffering. Jesus said to him, I will go and heal him. The centurion replied to him, Lord, I did not deserve to have you come under my roof, but just say the word. And my servant will be healed. For I myself am a man under authority with soldiers under me. And I tell this one, go, and he goes. And that one come, and he comes. And I say to my servant, do this, and he does it. When Jesus heard this, he was astonished. What does it take to astonish Jesus? I don't know, but this astonished him. This man's faith literally astonished him to see it firsthand. And he said to those following him, I tell you the truth, I have not found anyone in Israel with such great faith. He says, I have not found among God's chosen people anybody with a faith like this man, who's a centurion. I say to you that many will come from the east and the west, and they will take their places at the feast with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the subjects of the kingdom will be thrown outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Jesus is saying, you know, great faith is great faith, and I don't care what nationality it comes from. There's some people that belong at the table. There's some people that were born the right way, right? Born into the faith. They ought to be God's people, but they're not faithful. But this man is demonstrating great faith. Then Jesus said to the centurion, go, it will be done just as you have believed it would. And his servant was healed at that very hour. Amazing. Jesus is demonstrating that this man's belief has an effect on the outcome of this man's desire. Now, I don't know everything about this, and theologically we're talking about some deep water here, okay? There's some deep concept here. Does our belief in God have an effect on the promises or the reward that He gives? I have a hard time saying no to that. Do you understand? I don't know the full import of how that works out individually every time. And God's plan sometimes is greater than the one that I have in my head, and my plan doesn't work out. I don't believe that doesn't mean that God's plan didn't work out. Do you get that? Because I don't always know what the plan is. But let me say this. We better be people that live as though we believe God can do the things we ask Him to do. Shouldn't we? Shouldn't we do that? Shouldn't we live that way? That asks us to live confidently. God's plan is going to work out. It's going to work out. I need to live within His plan so that the things that I ask Him for are the right things. Let me tell you two things that I think are right for us to ask of Him. One is, I think it is right for us to ask for the boldness to enlarge the territory of His kingdom on this planet. I think that that's a right thing to ask for. And I think we as God's people here should be asking for that. Souls to be added to the kingdom. We need to be asking for that. We need to be asking for that all the time, and we need to be living within concert with that plan, within harmony of God's plan for that. Believing that He will do that if we ask for it, and that He'll use us to help do it. The second thing is, we need to be believing that God can help us do something great for the kingdom in this area. And I think that means planting a church, but I also think that means having two churches that love each other as sisters should. That's what we are. We'll be sisters, sister churches in the kingdom. And the love we demonstrate demonstrates some of the belief that we have in the God that we serve, doesn't it? I believe it does. Our faithfulness, our willingness to do what He says, to follow through the plans that He's made for us. To do things the way He's called on us to do those things. I think we should not shy away for one minute from doing what God has called us to do. And I know that we can do that better. I know that we can grow in that. God, the one who made the promises to us, is faithful. He is faithful. And you have ways that you've seen Him be faithful in your life. But we have a need to share that with a world that doesn't have that faith in Him, that doesn't know Him. God, in His great wisdom, chose a people for Himself, and from those people He carved out some that would be obedient. And every time in the Old Testament that His people go do terrible things, there's always a remnant. There's a small group that'll do what He says. And He keeps working through that remnant, and He will bring them back, and He will once again establish them, and He will promise them good things, and He'll fulfill those promises. The Old Testament's full of that. And then finally, He sends the Messiah, the one that He promised of old. We have so much prophecy in the Old Testament about that. And He sends Christ to die for us, to live an example for us to follow, to be the king that He said He was going to be, and to live victoriously after he died, was buried, and then came back to life to show us the way. That's the one that we serve. That's who we are. We are Christians. We are the people that belong to and emulate Christ in our life. I am confident that in that plan, there is no mistake. God has made it right, and he's laid it out for us. And Jesus said things like this. In John 12, he says, "If I'm lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men unto me." I believe that. Don't you believe that? And if we will tell that story, I believe it will make a difference in people's lives. How do I know that? Because I'm living that. Aren't you? Yeah, I'm living it imperfectly and I make mistakes, but the forgiveness is the sweetest thing about it, isn't it? Absolutely it is. And we have that to share with people that are hurting and lost. This world we live in today is sad. If you don't know that, then that means you don't have a computer. And maybe that's better today. I'll be honest. If you don't have a television, that's great. You probably live a happier life. But the fact is that the world we live in is sad and needs Jesus more than they ever have. We have an opportunity to share him with others. If you're here tonight and you have not become his child, if you do not belong to him, if you haven't washed away your sin, you have a chance to do that. I can't see it because it's really shallow, but there's water back there. And if we need more, we'll put more in there. But if we can help you tonight, if you know you need to do this and you want to be obedient to God, come and do that. If you've drifted from where you know you need to be, God is faithful and he loves you. And he's calling us to faithfulness too. If there's any way we can help, why don't you come while we stand and sing?